structure by function, and it didn't take long for people to be bored. Just doing the same thing over and over and over and over and over. I was fortunate enough to be in public safety, so even though I was doing primarily litigation, you know, we did like death penalty stuff, and so there was always, you know, like run down to the probate court in Butts County because somebody's trying to get a guardian appointed for the inmate so they can say he's not competent. Yeah. So it's always something new. And
were you under Arthur Bolton originally?
No, Mike hired me, and then I was there for a couple of years after Thurber came in.
As I go back to the days when I dealt with Bolton.
Well, and we always laughed. Mike stressed it was Mike. Was not Mr. Bowers, but everybody referred to Mr. Bolton. He was not Arthur.
So, let's see, Mike ran for governor, if I remember correctly.
That's where I met my wife. She was the receptionist.
Oh, sorry.
I bet you ruined her career. Yeah, because Mike said, congratulations, who's leaving? But then she now does church finance. She's a church comptroller. She loves it.
I didn't want people to have to walk over us.
I'm looking at the ring and that color looks real familiar. Where'd you go to school?
Spread your high school at Ledford area.
Just watch your high school.
Yep, still wear it. Still fit. That's kind of my, when I need to go on a diet, when it starts getting too cold and I'm off, it's time to get some exercise again.
I lost what you were going to say. I went to Carolina for law school. Blue is up.
Yeah. That's what I went to Mars Hill College, which is just up above Asheville. Which is, I say that out loud, but it's not a Mars Hill University.
Well, it's one of Mercer.
But, sweets.
Hi, gentlemen.
Hello, Mike.
I'm Kathy Echols.
Edwin Saginar.
Nice Saginar?
We met a few minutes
yes,
ago.
Yes,
nice behind you.
Yeah, me. Let's see. I got a little, because y'all probably by now can figure out who each other is.
I'm going to remind myself.
Let's see. And I told y'all I was bringing, that's what I have. Let's see. I'll give you agendas. Agendas? Yes, yes. Here you go, Nydia. Y'all need more than one?
Just
you're going to share? Okay. Let me go run and put these out front. I should have left them out front. Okay. wait a few minutes because it's toilet. Well, my battery must be done. Okay, well. Gentlemen, ready?
Sure.
Certainly.
I'm Kathy Echols, clerk to the Forsyth County Ethics Panel. It is August 6, 2004. I call the meeting of the Forsyth County Ethics Panel to order. Those present are Mr. Neal Childers, Mr. Edwin Saginar, Mr. Albert Norton Jr., and Kathy Echols, clerk, and various members of the public. It is now 2:01 p.m. The first item on the agenda, after I handed it all out to y'all, thank you, is the adoption of the agenda. Do I hear a motion to adopt?
Move to adopt.
Second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Next item on the agenda is the selection of a chairman. Is there a motion? Would somebody like to volunteer?
It's fine. I'm happy to.
Okay. I'm not sure really if that has to be done by a motion or not.
So
thank you.
Agreed.
Okay. And then all in favor. I will now turn the meeting over to Mr. Childers. I'm sorry.
That's fine. We are here today for the investigatory review of the complaint filed by Mr. Rorke against Commissioner Amos. The key member of the panel have a preference or suggestion how we proceed?
Well, an idea is, and read the complaint and the response, and understanding the standards we're supposed to follow in this proceeding, I would suggest we try to identify specific things that Mr. Rorke is saying constitute ethics violation. Investigatory review is what this is, to determine whether specific substantiated evidence from a credible source exists to support a reasonable belief. Is what we're about, as I understand it. So,
okay.
That would be my suggestion. Everyone in agreement?
That is fine with that.
Okay. Then let's look at Mr. Rorke's affidavit, which looks like it commences on the second page of our handout. I would propose that we consider the first area of review, the second paragraph down toward the middle of the page referencing a commission vote of February 20th of 2014.
That's a great one.
Okay.
So the specific issue then being the propriety of Mr. Amos participating in the road widening vote. I guess this wasn't February 20th.
Yeah, I agreed that that's the issue, yes. I think so.
Appears to be.
Now, having looked at the response or answer as it's denominated, on behalf of Mr. Amos, it appears that there were actually four votes with respect to Castleberry Road taken at that meeting.
I was trying to read the complaint affidavit combined with what the respondent was saying on this, and what I gather from this, and help me if I'm reading this wrong, is that apparently the road widening is something that was commenced and discussed going way back, as Mr. Rorke is saying.
That appears to be agreed upon by everybody.
Right.
Yes.
Trying to narrow it down to what's still an issue after you compare the complaint response. but that there were some votes relating to how to implement that. Part of the response said that, well, this is the implementation of SPLOST 4, 5, and 6, I think it was, you know, a series of SPLOSTs, and of course that means taxpayers voted on it and so on, but there is some action being taking place on February 20th by the Board of Commissioners to implement or to bring some specificity to the road widening problem.
Am I correct in saying that although the idea was passed upon more than 10 years ago, and certainly before Mr. Amos was involved with the County Commission, but it was not specifically funded, nor was there any statement about when work would begin for the process?
That's what I inferred. In fact, Mr. Rorke pointed to some early, I say early, going back several years, emails, 2007 and earlier, where there's discussion about, well, it's not really time yet, the traffic levels aren't sufficient, and so on. So, you know, whether that's true or not, I mean, I think one of the things that Mr. Rorke is saying is that the road shouldn't be widened. The vote should not have happened because of the road widening, but the issue I was focusing more on than that was just whether or not whatever did take place with respect to the road widening on February 20th, whether or not Mr. Amos should have been participating in it, given the proximity of the property that we have. That's what I gleaned from what Mr. Rorke was saying.
May I make one observation? I think we're bound by having to determine clear and convincing evidence, which in my mind is stronger than mere preponderance.
Well, I read the rules we're supposed to follow are not necessarily all in one place. So you really have to go through all of this to understand the rules. But because they've been amended, and you got to look at what was amended and all that. But I think that's correct. My understanding of what this proceeding is, we're doing an investigative review. We're not taking any evidence in order to determine whether it goes to another stage. And another stage would be the evidence taking phase if we get there. And that's where I think the clear and convincing comes in.
I think you're right. I think it's more like a preliminary inquiry.
Right.
And it's more of a probable cause type situation.
Well, probable cause, but there's the language used is some specific substantiated evidence. Credible sources. So what I read that to mean is that this complaint from Mr. Rorke needs to, I mean, he's got his own observations, of course, which it's under oath, so it's evidence, but it needs to be specific, and I guess this standard recognizes that we're not trying to follow the federal rules of evidence necessarily, but the general idea of, you can't just say it's so and therefore it's so.
Can't be opinion, it has to be based on premised upon facts.
That's how I think. And it's reasonable belief, really, is the words used, as I understand. I'm reading the right one. I think I am right one.
I think you are.
Is there any evidence to demonstrate that there aren't 15,000 cars a day passing on this particular road?
Well,
or do we presuppose
there's,
that?
There's not that I see, but I'll tell you, my take on that when I read it is whether or not the road widening ought to happen and whether or not the SPLOST ought to be implemented and all that is what the Bureau the Board of Commissioners is supposed to do. And so, we're not supposed to be an appeal board for what they do. We're supposed to determine whether it's reasonable belief of an ethics violation. So I didn't really, I read it all, but I didn't really focus too much on how many cars there are. And I don't think that's really necessary to the decision.
Well, my thinking was, would the vote go that way anyway, even if Ms. Amos didn't vote? That's where I'm coming from in that area.
Oh. Well, according to the minutes, it would have been a 2-2 vote if he had abstained.
I'll tell you what in my thought process and reading the complaint response was, it seems to me significant. If you look at the specific things that Mr. Rorke is saying constitute ethical violations, it's conflict of interest, it's some of these more vaguely stated items that are in the code. It seems like it comes down to the proximity of his own property. this is what the commissioners are supposed to do, is implement and execute these kinds of things. Why would it be improper for Mr. Amos to participate in that bill? If February 20th, he has not yet indicated that he's got a conflict on the zoning issue. The zoning issue's not even in play, as far as I know, at least not for the board. All that's happening is this vote on February 20th about implementing the spurs to do the road widening. So at that point in time, is the proximity of his property such that he is somehow gaining by doing this road widening? Is what I saw is the, and I'm really having to kind of read between some lines to get that.
And I don't see anything in the, are we calling this a complaint, I guess? I don't see any indication in the complaint of any evidence that the proposed sales transaction or anything like that was in place on February the 20th.
So that would have to be garnered through evidence, which is not before this group anyway at this point.
Well, I mean, there's not a contention that at the time of the vote, any of these factors are present.
All right. Query, what happens if it were in a process of being negotiated? Would there be a duty at that point to disclose and then recuse himself, getting up and saying, hey, I can't be here because I'm involved with a family situation where we own a substantial amount of property which may be impacted by this resolution?
Yeah. It makes sense as a valid inquiry. There is an address that for his property with Mr. Rorke. It appears to be off of, you don't know where to that, but it's off of Bethelview and Castleberry Road, the road widening, the road is being widened. I'm not familiar with all of it. But I looked it up and it runs on the corner of Highway 9, Castleberry Road. And then if you notice, they found it in 13 Bethelview, fairly extensive northwest. And so that his property is going up and off Bethelview. And as Mr. Rorke says, well, I didn't look up the mileage, but Mr. Rorke said it's 3 miles away. So it's not on Castleberry. Whether or not widening Castleberry would somehow enhance commercial traffic to the road that he is on. I saw the address on the bill, I don't remember what the address was. I have no way of knowing.
Well, he denies that the improvement would in any way enhance the value in his answer.
Right. My concern is, going back to your point a minute ago, I went back to Mr. Rorke's complaint to find something other than his statement that, gosh, I'm trying to flip through to find it, but there was a statement, it might have even been his rebuttal, what he described as a rebuttal, that it's just 3 miles away, therefore this is a conflict of interest. So that was a concern to me, although lack of evidence, which is what we're supposed to evaluate. But if Mr. Amos submits a zoning request on people April the 4th, it's April 4th is not the first day that it came to his mind that he might be selling that property. I keep saying he, but I think it's family property, which I don't think there's any dispute about in the response. But,
well, and looking at the specific conflict of interest provisions in the ordinance as amended, it prohibits acquiring or maintaining an interest in a contract or transaction but there's no allegation that there is any interest in any action being taken by the county here. I mean, there's no contention that there's being a contract awarded by Mr. Amos to himself or to some company he has an interest in.
Yeah, I guess what it comes down to for me is I was looking at the timing of these events, and that raised a concern in my mind as I'm reading through the papers. You know, just because you're a commissioner doesn't mean that you can't hold the property, you can't do things a normal citizen would do. So is there a connection to this property that may very well have been, in discussion as far as a sale, as far back as February 20th, is there some indication that the value of that property is going to be enhanced by virtue of this road widening in such a way that maybe that calls for a disclosure and extension? Because the response is, yeah, there was disclosure and there was extension as to the zoning issue, which we haven't gotten to yet.
Right. And that was what, May the 12th?
May 1st, I think it was, if I recall.
May 1st. So the April meeting, there was no disclosure.
Well, actually, I think April was just a submission of an application.
Okay.
So February 20th is the key that you're talking about, which is where there were votes related to the road widening. By the way, I maybe y'all know more about this or figure out more in the papers, but the response said, look, this goes back to 10 years to explosives and we're going to implement the road widening and that sort of thing. And therefore, it's just now, and this was back before Mr. Amos was even a commissioner. So I understand that part. But if he does become a commissioner, and then there are substantive road widening votes being taken on February 20th. So I don't really know how it goes from being disclosed to being implemented by the commissioners. I don't know the inner workings of how all this plays out. But what matters to us, I think, is there were substantive votes taken on February 20th by Mr. Ames relating to the road widening. Whether or not that somehow implicates his personal interests or not is a different question. That's what I'm looking to complain for evidence on, not let us see.
Yeah, I would agree with you that the February 20th votes, based upon the evidence submitted in Mr. Amos's response, were clearly substantive because one of the votes was on a motion to rescind action from November 15th, 2012, and those minutes are in the response as well. I went back and looked at them, and basically at that point in time, the board had made a decision not to proceed with the same scope of widening as had originally been proposed in the SPLOST. And now by rescinding that, the board has actually made a substantive choice about how to fulfill the project. But we still come down to, since it seems like both parties agree that the property owned by the Amos family is 3 miles away from the property, does that create a conflict of interest? And what I'm kind of struggling with is there's rather conclusory statements by Mr. Rorke that it does and by Mr. Amos that it doesn't. But
what harm would they have been in disclosing it at that time? Why is the disclosure later where he recuses himself?
Well, for sake of argument, let me guess what Mr. Amos might say. He might say, wait a minute, I own some property in the county. I also didn't disclose something that was 20 miles away, 25 miles away. I mean, at what point do I mean, he's got duties as a commissioner too. So he would probably say, at what point do I abandon my job, my duties as a commissioner, recuse myself? At least as that one little issue is recused himself, he's no longer participating, which is what he is supposed to otherwise do. At what point, and obviously when his personal interests are implicated, but if they wouldn't be implicated if the property were 20 miles away, what if it's 3 miles away? It depends on the road corridors, depends on the occupants.
But you've also got to consider the rule of necessity. There are no provisions for an alternate or replacement commissioner if a commissioner recuses. So they have actually, when not laboring under a conflict of interest, the duty to attend the meetings and cast votes to represent their constituents. And so you've got the countervailing, unless there is a conflict of interest, he has to stay.
I don't see any mechanics in the ordinances, and correct me if I'm wrong, that if you said, okay, I'm going to advise the rest of the commissioners publicly of my interest and let them determine whether or not I should recuse myself. I don't think there is a dynamic for that. If that had been an option, that would have been an option he could have taken.
Yeah, that's true. I don't see anything like that either, but there's a good many kind of aspirational statements in the ethical rules. But it still goes back to you gotta have some real reason to think they're implicated.
All right, have there been impact studies that we could get into evidence and hear about, which would indicate traffic flow and impacting upon value of property in this area?
I just in case you're interested in looking at it, I actually print off as Google Maps. I think that's okay for me to do, right? I'll take judicial notice of it. Y'all will see that's the real property that's right there, and that's that highlighted it as customary. And that road that I'm going north south that I highlighted is Bethlehem.
So the X is the property. Well, I do know that Mr. Amos's response does indicate that there is a traffic study from September of 2011 confirming the need is designed, although I don't think the study itself is in the response. On the other hand, we also don't have anything from Mr. Rorke other than his statement as to what the count is, and he does not indicate where, even assuming his numbers are correct, accurate, he doesn't give us any indication of where they come from.
Well, just remember there's two issues there. One is the traffic study that shows the need for whatever widening course they ultimately took on Castleberry. The other issue is whether or not that affects Mr. Amos's family's property. And I don't know if the traffic report, like, as you say, it's not there, so I don't know whether that traffic report would show that the redirection of traffic or something would help fall in or make hurt the property of Mr. Amos.
I would imagine, I'm just guessing, just by memory, the speed limit on Bethel View is 45 or 55 miles an hour, and I don't know what it is on Castleberry, but assuming that, if you went at 60 miles an hour, it's a mile a minute. So even if it's 3/4 of a mile for every minute, you get to that area very quickly. So 2 or 3 miles is quite close, and it certainly could impact.
Could.
But there is. But he doesn't present. The complainant doesn't present evidence. He just presents the assumption that it will increase the value. What's his background? He doesn't tell us what kind of work he does. Is he in real estate? Is he a broker? Is he someone who finances these type of transactions for him to reach this conclusion?
I would hope that the exercise of printing off the map would make it self-evident one way or the other, but it's not going to be.
Yeah. Well, and I think, too, what we come to, I think you made the point a couple minutes ago. Sometimes widening the highway helps, sometimes it hurts your values.
It can ruin a restaurant, for example, if you don't have a good ingress and egress.
You could pull commercial traffic that otherwise would go up Bethlehem down to Castleberry. There's all kinds of possibilities.
All of which would
most likely on our part at this point, based on what we have, be speculation. Do we want to try to make a conclusion on these individually, or do we want to go ahead and discuss the next one and then come back and make decisions?
I would go for talking about all of them and come back.
I agree.
Okay, go away.
Okay. That way we get the compendium of thinking.
Okay.
Let's see. And it looks like you kind of have to read a couple of places together to get this, but it appears the second issue would be the submission of a rezoning request to the county for the subject property on behalf of the owners, and they were actually submitted by a developer listing the owners of the property, which included the strangers.
Yeah, I took it that I was trying to, there's some things kind of jumbling together, but I was trying to parse them out to make sure we hit whatever it could be that he's raising. Because there may be 10 issues and one of them needs to get through, or nine of them need to get through. But in any event, I think what one of the things he's saying is that as a city commissioner, he should not have submitted his own request at all.
I agree. I think that's certainly an issue that he's presented.
Assuming you recuse and you don't participate, maybe y'all know more about this than I do, but my thought is you own property in the county, you've got property rights like everybody else does.
There's no other place to seek rezoning.
What else are you going to do?
Right.
Like, there's not some alternative venue. Become a commissioner and then abandon all your rights as a citizen. I don't want to overstate it, but obviously, if you are a commissioner, you're in a position to exercise some pretty strong influence on a situation like that. So, what do you do? What's the remedy? How do you get around it? And I think, and I'm totally open to contrary suggestion on this, but I think that the ordinance, the ethics rules, deal with that with the recusal and the from the mark that he keeps using where you don't participate.
Abstention.
Well, he mentions that it's latent. Well, latent, of course, would be hidden intimidation. It's either intimidation or not intimidation. I don't think you can be half pregnant in that regard. So can you really intimidate someone unless you have the power to hire and fire? Are staff members, how are they hired? What staff is he talking about? Is he talking about a planning commission? If he's talking about a planning commission or planning group, does the county commission on a regular basis hire and fire these folks?
Yeah, I take your point. I don't think folks are going to sit around saying, oh, my job's in jeopardy necessarily if I don't do this. But I also think that, of course, a county commissioner is going to a large weight. People are going to go, oh, this is Mr. Amos or whoever's. When I've seen situations where a public official is being called to answer for something, very often people are, let's say it's law enforcement or something like this, and I think a lot of times there's more scrutiny brought to bear on the public official because he's a public official than a private citizen is in the same situation. So I think we got to be careful not to err either way. But I'm not seeing anything from the complaint. I just saw my bottom line on this that would suggest that merely submitting the zoning applications by itself an ethical violation. There may be related things.
Well, should the zoning application have included the disclosure?
Yeah, I,
I took that as a separate, I wrote that as a separate issue because you can't parse those two. I guess that'll be the next issue.
Well, and Mr. Rorke indicates that the application disclosed ownership of the property by, I guess, that Mr. Amos, and I guess that's his wife. Sorry.
So he's in that too. I mean, there's no question he's.
Yeah, that was not, it's not like he's hiding the fact that he owned the property.
Well.
He's damned if he does, damned if he doesn't. If he doesn't disclose it, oh, it's ethical. If he does disclose it, it's intimidation. So he's caught on the horns of a dilemma.
I didn't think of that. I had gone through the issues best I could get them out of the complaint and answer first, and then went back and reread the ordinance. I think what we're supposed to do is figure out if there's a reasonable belief there's been a violation of the ethics rules. Well, of this ordinance, essentially, sure, the ethics rules. There, as I said before, there's several aspirational kind of ethics statements in there. But as far as a particular rule that you can see it in black and white that's been violated or not been, the rule that I read that's pertinent, so tell me if you saw another one that's involved, but the one I read that seems pertinent is if you have a conflict of interest, potential conflict of interest in this situation, you don't take any action, you recuse or abstain. He did that on the first, and then he did not participate, according to him, and I don't see this being, that is Mr. Payments, and I don't see this being disputed. He did not participate.
Well, and there was, this is not conflicting, but supplementing that, there was another provision I noted that although a commissioner is not supposed to advocate for other individuals to the county staff, there's a specific exception to that prohibition for himself, his spouse, his or her spouse, and their minor children, that they are allowed under the specific terms of the ordinance to basically exercise their own First Amendment rights in their personal capacity.
You go deeper on that than I did, but that makes perfect sense. I'll see how it could be otherwise.
Okay. Under the zoning application, generally, I've got two issues so far. Did you parse out any more?
I had two other issues and a general question. Two issues were the complaint. As I read it, said Mr. Amos should have recused himself from any business being presented by Lennar, which is his head development firm, I think, that was doing the zoning change, and I guess in anticipation, I guess they had a contract with the Amoson for the properties. Well, for that specific, seems to be the setup. So that, he's saying that that Mr. Amos should have recused from any business presented by Lennar. This would have nothing to do with the road widening or the zoning or any of that stuff, just any business presented by Lennar, because he personally is doing business with Lennar.
And I agree with you. I think that's the next issue. I had just two thoughts on that. One was having no idea how often this company comes before the board, although Mr. Rorke indicates that it's a regular basis. There's nothing before us to even indicate that they've had an item to be decided by the board since the zoning application and sale of the property. So from my perspective, the first observation was just, we don't know that there's ever even been an occasion for Mr. Amos to consider whether he should or shouldn't recuse.
Yes. What did Mr.
Rorke saying that I'd seen something from him specifically.
He said, it's long established in Forsyth County that the law of Georgia comes before the DOC on a regular basis for all sorts of requests, but there's no indication that they have actually done so since, if we assume for the sake of discussion, that there is a conflict. There's no indication that there's been any.
Well, how much of an onus do we put upon a citizen to adduce essentially evidence to get beyond the point where there is actually an inquiry made beyond just this investigatory discussion today?
Yeah, that's a great question, because I had to keep going back and trying to get that back in my head, because I think we have to look at the standard of proof that the specific question we're being asked, because it's not for us to decide what we think philosophically ought to be the answer to that question. If you're charged with following the rules that exist in Forsyth County for what the ethics board is supposed to do with this state for this proceeding.
Yeah, and the ordinance provides, we're determining if there is specific substantiated evidence from a credible source or sources that exist to support a reasonable belief that there has been a violation.
All right, we have his affidavit, Mr. Rorke. Is he a credible source? Do we know anything about the man?
I have no reason to think he's not, but to me, if you're going to make an assertion that certain, that there were certain types of transactions, and these are matters, you know, they're public matters by definition, then I think what you do is adduce them. You don't just say there have been some.
We don't have any evidence whether or not Mr. Rorke has been denied by the commission in the past, has any bad blood as a result of his own experiences. We have nothing to go by.
I have no idea. There's no indication in any of his filings that he sought documents and was denied.
He had some complaints about the timing of the events and the rules and so on, and not entirely unsympathetic, but you don't follow the rules, and you're in trouble for not following the rules. You don't have a set of rules that applies to everybody. You do follow the rules, and they criticize because the rules ought to be something other than what they are. I think the responsible thing, whether it's the outcome I would go for or not, is to apply as absolutely stringently as we can exactly what the standards are and exactly what the requirements are that are suggested to us by the ethics rules or the ordinance, I should say.
One thing that we might take notice of, Mr. Amos's family has owned this property for a long, long time. It's not as if he went out to acquire it to make a sweetheart deal with his position being on the board. This has been his family property. Should his sons be denied the opportunity to develop and make a sweet deal just because their dad is an influential man who, you know, who does public good by being on a board?
Well, absolutely not. Yeah. If there were reason to say that they should, then it would have to be based on some indication that the that Mr. Amos brought about the sweetheart deal by his maneuver, his public maneuvers, which is, I think, the first issue we went through.
Yeah, that comes back to that initial vote.
Because we deal, I'm sorry, I was going to say, you mentioned earlier about aspirational language. Mm-hmm. You know, when we look at the bar rules, we have that ABA language, which would hold you to the standard of being the head of some religion and never leaving the house, or the realistic ones. And is it aspirational language, or isn't it, to hold this gentleman to being as clean and unassailable as sees his wife?
Right. Well, there's appearance of impropriety language, but that just sort of begs the question.
Well, let me ask you one more issue about, let's look kind of at the other side of the coin on here, is there, if we assume for the sake of discussion that Mr. Rorke is correct, that this developer regularly does come before the board, is the fact that they apparently have entered into a, probably a contingent contract, contingent on the rezoning, but a contract to purchase property from a city commissioner, is that per se a conflict under the county ordinances? Is that a conflict of interest? Not on that particular transaction, but on anything else they may have to bring before the county. Again, there's no other commission they can go to either.
Right. I'm going to assume for purposes of this discussion that this transaction took a long time to reach an agreement, that it was perhaps even significantly before February, because there's a lot of money involved. There are issues, I'm certain, that you have to face. So it was known about, I'm certain, by Mr. Amos quite a while ago. That's an assumption, just based upon the size of the transaction. With that in mind, that the date in May is what bothers me. May 1st disclosure. I don't care about the fact that his wife makes a statement to the press. That's standard promotion. And the average person looking on TV probably couldn't even figure it. It's the wife of the head of the commission. But I'm concerned about the date in February that he would have known about it then. That's what sort of sets my concern.
And then, of course, that's recuse, and I keep saying recuse, so I think that's the word, the disclosure and extension. So what would he have disclosed back at that time, that I've got a contract with Menard? Is that the idea?
Menard, it deals with a specific piece of property, which could have some impact by the widening of Castleberry, which the commission years ago went along with but never funded. And am I correct in saying it went along with SPLOST, but there was no direct funding done?
Right, and whatever the scope of what they're doing now, we, the commission, are doing a vote here on April 20th to implement the road widening.
And to jumpstart it, essentially.
Actually, in February, I don't know that there would have been any reason to disclose a relationship with Lennar per se, because as far as I could tell, they have no involvement with or connection to the road widening. It's not like they're also going to be a contractor on that project. I think in that sense, the issue becomes, was there a need to disclose that, hey, I might benefit by this road widening because I've got some property, I think we agreed, everybody said it was 3 miles away. And if we widen it in the way that's being proposed, you know, maybe I'll come out. And I think that's the potential disclosure, I guess, is the best way to phrase it at this point, that would have been made.
That one, but how about just simply, hey, I've got a contract with Lennar. We all know that Lennar is in front of us all the time, so I'm disclosing that I have this contract with Lennar.
Well, but again, that wouldn't have necessarily been relevant on February the 20th, because none of the votes deal with Lennar. Yeah, that's why I say I think if there's something to disclose, it's the fact of ownership of property.
Yeah.
Who the potential developer might be wasn't really relevant to those votes.
I think it's ownership.
Yeah, just coming back to that first issue.
Now, where it is, kind of circling back around, where it does become relevant, who the developer is kind of what I'm, in my notes, I've jotted down as issue 3B. Which is there an obligation on the part of Mr. Amos to disclose and abstain from any votes on any matters that brought before the commission by Lennar? And if so, I guess, for how long?
Yeah.
It could be forever. Theoretically, if he has a business relationship with him. His projects take quite a while. But it certainly be the remainder of his term.
Is there a reasonable possibility that because he's got this ongoing deal with Lennar on his property, the family property, Lennar comes before the board, that he would influence the board to go with or go against Lennar on some unrelated matter because it might somehow benefit his relationship with Lennar?
Yeah, I think that's the concern Mr. Rorke is raising, without casting aspersions one way or the other on Mr. Amos.
Right. Well, to me, this all goes back to the amount of proof necessary during this investigation aspect. If we're going to apply something equivalent to probable cause, it is a very small amount of evidence. Or at least a thinking that something might have occurred here. But if we're going to get down to a hearing, then obviously that weight of evidence shifts greatly to the favor of the person who's been accused.
You mean slim evidence of there being, Lennar being before the board on other matters, or slim evidence of there being influence exercised on those occasions? Because it looks slim on both those things.
Well, and also, too, looking back at the ethics ordinance, we're supposed to, and I'll leave out all the other part, but determine whether or not there's a reasonable belief that there has been a violation. I don't think that a potential future violation falls within that. By definition, we're looking at something that has happened
historically.
So I think in terms of whether or not Mr. Amos has any obligation to abstain from all matters brought by Lennar, he has the opportunity to request an advisory opinion from a panel about what should I do on that. But it's not a past violation to be addressed here.
Absolutely, I agree.
I'm reading Mr. Rorke's complaint here. It is long established in Forsyth County that Lennar, Georgia comes before the BOCs on a regular basis for all sorts of requests. Is there more? Have I missed something? This is the only thing that I remember him saying about that.
Right, and then the next sentence that kind of this was litigation, I would say the relief requested would be that he should recuse himself. It's not spelled out, but kind of implied all future discussions, votes, or recommendations. That's why I'm saying I don't think that's before us in a complaint from a citizen.
But he does want to vacate a vote.
The road widening vote?
Yes. The first vote he wants to vacate. Yeah,
that's further down. But in terms of the relationship with the company, that second paragraph on the third page, I agree with you, is all he has said about votes on matters by the developer.
Yeah, that's in futuro. It's not before us, I think.
And then the next paragraph is, I think, simply another basis upon which he believes there's another future conflict, and that is that they share counsel.
Yeah, I had that as a fifth issue. We used the same lawyers.
That to me is innuendo. I don't think there's any factual basis.
I don't believe as a matter of law that's a conflict of interest. There are a limited number of attorneys in any
venue who do real estate transactional work. So there will obviously, they're always going to, you know, I don't know any law firm that can successfully only have one client. So. Then looking, did you get an issue out of the next paragraph? I did not. The one that references the press release.
No, I didn't. I just took it that this is kind of building on the idea that he benefited from the ownership of this property. He says this is just morally wrong, but I don't really. I take that as just being a summation of what he's already said to me.
Yeah, did you?
No, I did not, but I do find one thing interesting, and I'm a little confused as to the dollars involved. Apparently, the announcement to the media talked about a 280 figure. And then later on in the next paragraph, talking about being objective of when you're dealing with 20 to 30 million.
Well, I think
one is land and the other one is the total development, yeah, I'm assuming.
That's what I heard. Okay. And I think what the precise numbers are is.
No, I don't think that has any bearing, that announcement.
So then I construed that final paragraph as being basically what Mr. Rorke is asking us to do, which is one, void the February 20 vote, and two, prohibit involvement of the family in zoning and planning requests. Do y'all agree?
Right.
Yes. It's not, he's not seeking punishment. He's certainly not seeking his job.
Substantive issues besides those? I numbered these five different issues, but I guess you could number different ones.
Yeah, I was going to say, I've got five, although I numbered them as subsets of two.
I guess when I suggested we proceed this way procedurally, but the first thing that there is another issue on the table, that is whether or not we should consider this submission by Mr. Rorke that came in Monday.
Of course, in order to consider that, we also have to address the objection and motion to strike,
yes,
file the response to it.
I'll just tell you, I got this everyone referring to it as a rebuttal. So I got this rebuttal from Mr. Warren, who read it before I got the motion to strike. My overall opinion was that, actually, because the way my thinking was going was, well, you know, if he's, you know, first of all, it's good that citizens can look in on what the government is doing and have the opportunity to make criticisms and to get resolution of issues they raise. So it's a positive thing. It can be abused. And so we don't want to squelch that. You know, I talked earlier about the rules, you got to follow the rules, but you know, on the other hand, you don't want to be so nitpicky about them that people can't get a reasonable say. So when I got this rebuttal, I wanted to look at it and see if it's going to add something so significant to what the complaint already has that perhaps there needs to be an opportunity to let them respond to this. I don't know what form that takes. I don't even know if this is provided for the rules, but some sort of, you're shaking your head, no?
Yeah, it looked like the rules were just silent on that. Although I did note, and I'm like you, I had read it before I received the objection, the motion to strike. My perception was that most of it dealt with, for lack of a better way to phrase it, the wisdom of the decision.
Yeah.
To change the plans for Castleberry Road, which I think we've all agreed is beyond the scope of what we're looking at.
Yes, I agree.
I would agree.
Just rather than speculating about what we would do procedurally, if this added more to the equation, I read through this to try to glean whether or not there's additional issues or more added than issues that are in play, to see how that would affect how we go forward.
I would propose, since I think we do have an obligation to address a motion before us, I would propose that we entertain a motion as to how y'all think we should rule on the motion. I guess that's the best procedural way.
Sure, yeah. The motion that Jack said that this was not, this additional submission by Mr. Rorke is not verified. I did not look again to see, to verify whether it was a verification.
And since it was submitted by email, that's probably correct. There was also an objection on the ground that it was untimely. And that the submission doesn't afford Mr. Amos time to reply. But that kind of gets into the whole, he had his 30 days to respond to the initial complaint. And I didn't see any new issues raised in the rebuttal that would have prejudiced him by not being able to respond.
Thought the rebuttal was more like an attempt to have a closing argument than it was adding any issues.
Right, I agree.
I think it's unfair to counsel for Mr. Amos and to Mr. Amos himself to have a rebuttal at the last moment that he cannot respond to. Of course, he did make a response. He made an objection, but in all, you know, dealing with pleadings all the time and living in courthouses, I don't like people who do things at the last moment, put me at disadvantage to my client. And I just think, even though the complainant doesn't know the rules necessarily, nor should we necessarily hold him to the standard, the concept of fairness comes in here. So I think that the motion to strike should be granted.
I agree, not because of time on this, but because I don't think that, first of all, it's not evidence, therefore it's not specific substantiated evidence that would support a reasonable belief that to any extent the outlets in the initial complaint.
Anyone opposed?
No. I'm agreeing.
And then let me restate it so that Ms. Echols can have a good good record of the motion. The initial motion was to deny the, to grant the objection motion to strike on the basis of timeliness. The second proposed an amendment to the motion to grant the motion to strike on the basis that it was not specific substantiated evidence which we could consider. Mr. Saginar accepted the modification, and then we agreed to the ruling on that basis.
Yes, and I would add that I think it's unfair. I think fairness has to play into this.
Any further discussion on identifying the issues presented by Mr. Rorke?
Those were all the ones that I identified before coming in here, so. I'm open to whether I miss something.
Well, one thing I find interesting, in the response to paragraph four to the complaint, Mr. Amos, the counsel, indicates just as affirmatively in reverse as to what Mr. Rorke said. He says in the pleadings, the widening of Castlebury Road does not affect the value of the land being sold, and Mr. Amos timely submitted disclosures and abstained from further action regarding the zoning. So just as it was conclusionary on the part of the complainant, it was by the respondent. Just merely a denial that it improves it. So I don't think we glean anything from either side, but the burden would have been on Mr. Rorke,
right,
to have shown it.
I agree with that. I read that and I thought, well, that sounds like a fact issue, and that's evidence, and that would be a subsequent hearing. But that's that. If we would approach it that way, that would, I think, ignore the charge we have in section one of ordinance number 77.
Yeah, I think rather than probable cause, the better analogy, considering the language used in the ordinance, would be this is almost like a judge considering a summary judgment motion. Is there enough evidence, not allegations, but is there evidence to create an issue warranting a hearing?
Right.
And so on that basis, I would agree with you that where we have conclusory statements from each side that yes, it enhances the value, no, it doesn't, but no evidence supporting either, then I agree with Mr. Saginar, because the ordinance puts the burden on Mr. Rohr, then I would have to conclude that at least as to that narrow issue, there's just not an issue for hearing.
Yeah, I agree. And I think it has to be that way, too, because, you know, if there are untoward things going on in the county government, they ought to be ferreted out of government. But there's a countervailing consideration, and that is, if things grind to a halt, if you can come forward with conclusory statements that are unsubstantiated, and put somebody in a position of battling claims of ethical violations. So I think it's fair and reasonable to hold someone to the standard that I read the ordinance is requiring anyway, which is to come forward with specific substantiated evidence sufficient to give us a reason to believe that there's been a violation.
I think the summary judgment analogy is a good one.
So my conclusion from reading Mr. Rourke's submission is that he was making two requests of the panel. Number one, to void the February 20th vote, and number two, it's a little slippery here, but reading some in between the lines is basically require that Mr. Amos abstain from any involvement in zoning and planning issues for the subject property. So let's talk about the first request first. Looking at the current version of the ordinance, which is 77-I, as in India, section 15 of the ordinance, which is on page 8, spells out the authority of the ethics panel, and I'm leaping to this with the assumption, or assuming without deciding at this point, that we were to conclude there has been some violation. With respect to the request that we
void that vote, I would point you to paragraph 15C, which gives that authority to a court, not to the ethics panel, and further requires that the legal action to request that the action of the commission in this case be voided within 90 days of the occurrence of the official action. And even the complaint to us was submitted more than 90 days after the vote that was complained of. So at least individually, it would appear to me that that is just not simply relief that we would have the authority to grant, assuming we found a violation.
I would agree.
Okay. And then I think we have already discussed and concluded that as far as future actions, whether or not there must be recusal and abstention, is that that would be something to be taken up if Mr. Amos chose to request an advisory opinion, but is not something we can rule on in a complaint because it hasn't happened yet.
Right, I agree, because it would just be an advisory opinion that someone's supposed to follow the ethics.
Right.
Which is already true.
Right. Now, having said that, I don't think we can grant any of the relief Mr. Rorke has requested, but I also don't believe that under Section 15, that's all we can do. I think we still have to make a determination of whether or not, in the words of the ordinance, that there is so dizzy flipping back and forth. Specific substantiated evidence from a credible source to support a reasonable belief that there has been a violation. So we come back, I think, to the February 20th vote. Do we believe that there is specific substantiated evidence to support a reasonable belief that voting on the four motions pertaining to the Castleberry Road widening was a violation of the ethics code?
What about the 90-day restriction? Doesn't it have to occur within 90 days?
That's the way I read the section, that only provided to bring an action to request a court to void the action.
Just the court?
Yes.
Yeah, I read it narrowly like that as well.
Does anyone want to make a motion so we can discuss that issue?
The issue we're on now is whether or not Mr. Amos should have participated in the road widening vote on February 20th.
Yes.
Yes, I guess to say this in a formal motion, I would move for a finding that there is not an ethics violation.
So that we can use the words of the statute, will you accept a friendly amendment?
Yes, certainly. Yes, I've been quoting it all along as I do, finding that there's not specific substantiated evidence from credible sources which exists to support a reasonable belief that there has been a violation of the rules.
I have a problem with that, because what we're doing, all right, we want citizens to come forward.
Let me second it just so we're in order to discuss it, and then go ahead.
my concern is, okay, we have a citizen who's concerned. He sees something that doesn't look right to him for whatever motivation. He keeps up with what goes on here, and that's a good thing. This government could be tyrannical, and we don't want it to be that way on any level. So now the question comes up, how much duty is there upon this individual to conduct an investigation, to adduce enough information before what amounts to is a screening process, which is what today is? Or is it the public's thinking that seeing enough that he participated in a vote, discussed the situation, that it should lead to an inquiry where evidence is actually brought in. So to me, the question is, what is imposed upon Mr. Rorke when he brings this? Do we expect the equivalent of an indictment with particularity, or a complaint that would be filed by a member of the bar who's been doing it 20 years? Or do we expect to have someone to say, this doesn't smell right, he hadn't recused himself by then, he participated in the discussions, isn't that enough for y'all to make an inquiry? And isn't that what this man wants? He's not being punitive, he's not seeking this gentleman's job, he's not even looking to fine him. What he's trying to do is stop transactions like this from occurring where a commissioner might have an interest. So that's what concerns me. And so that's why I kept going into the level of evidence necessary. What must this man bring before us, or any citizen, woman or man, to make it to the point where there needs to be some sort of, for want of a better word, evidentiary hearing?
I see your point. Where I got hung up on that exact same point was, this keeps being referred to as an investigatory review. So we're to investigate it. But your point is well taken. The last, I think there should be very good, very reasonable avenues for someone to come in and make complaints about exactly this sort of thing. The public officials, they're out there doing things just, you know, without even intending to cause somebody harm, they can create all kinds of harm. And they have to do things the right way. They have to be extremely scrupulous about these ethics rules. I know it sounds like, you know, I'm being overly focused on the rules and what the standard of the rule is, but this is the rule that is the law for proceeding with this kind of matter. As a voter, I might say, of course I'm not a voter in Forsyth County, but I might say, you know, these rules need to be loosened up, and there needs to be some independent investigation, somebody come alongside somebody who's saying it doesn't smell right, and come along with the specific substantiated evidence that's necessary. You know, maybe that's the right way to go, but it's not the way to go that we have.
What happens if he appeared today? He sent the message indicating that he can't be here. He's a working individual. If he appeared here today, would we have heard his testimony?
We're not allowed to.
No, we're not allowed to. So that's what I'm trying to say. We're precluded from, and the use of the word investigation is an inappropriate word, I believe, for these proceedings.
I agree.
I think it's a screening proceeding. It's not an investigation.
But see, I think that cuts the other way, really. The fact that we don't hear evidence here is the reason why the papers that do get submitted have to be specific substantiated evidence, precisely because we don't come in and swear witnesses and start taking evidence. It's a two-step process.
So he would have had to really hire an attorney to become familiar with these rules so that he could reach the precipice and the requirements for this to pass muster.
Well, you put me in a position of defending the rules.
No, I'm just saying, I understand that. But I'm attacking the rules.
If I'm charged with writing the rules, I might have done it differently, but those are the ones we have. And the ones that are accessible to Mr. Rorke in order to come up with this complaint.
And you know, there are thousands of cases that talk about if you choose to proceed pro se, you still have to learn and comply with the rules of procedure that govern whatever type of matter you're handling.
But that usually addresses litigation. Mm-hmm. This man is not a plaintiff in a lawsuit, nor is he a defendant.
Yeah,
he's a citizen.
I agree. I don't think that's an ideal parallel here. I think citizens ought to be able to come in and call their public officials to task when there's grounds.
And having been in-house counsel with various government agencies for 22 years, I understand why the law provides what it does, because you do get a lot of what are frivolous and unfounded complaints based upon lack of knowledge. Not to say that's Mr. Rorke's, but I understand why they're written that way, but then it creates the problem you identified. But I don't think that we as a panel of three have the ability to rewrite the ordinance. Any further discussion?
Nothing further from me.
Anything from you?
Your points are well taken.
Are we ready to vote?
Yeah.
The motion was to, flip back one more time so that I phrase it correctly. The motion was to find that following the investigatory review, as the term is provided in the ordinance, that there has not been specific substantiated evidence from a credible source, although I don't think the motion was based upon credibility, to support a reasonable belief that there has been a violation of the ordinance. Are we ready to vote?
I'm trying to make sure I get my message right. I voted in favor of that because I believe there has not been specific substantiated evidence to support this vote.
Correct. That was the motion was to find there had not been.
Yes.
I agree that based upon the rules that we're under and these proceedings, I'd have to go along.
And I agree as well. Any further business? I don't think there's anything else on the agenda.
Well, I want to make sure we covered it because that issue was the priority of Mr. Harris participating in the roadblock.
Right.
There were several other things that we've gone through. These other four issues that he raised, are they all mooted by what we just voted on? I have to think about that.
Well, that's a good point. I had jotted down, I thought we had agreed that the prospect of recusal from matters concerning Lennar was not something that was properly before us. Should we take a formal motion and vote on that?
Chair or not, I agree with that.
I agree. It's prospective, not retroactive or retrospective.
Just so that our record's clear, then let me make a motion that the panel find that the issues concerning the propriety of votes that might take place in the future on matters brought before the commissioners by, is it Lennar, Georgia? Anyway, by that company, are not properly before the panel because they have not yet occurred.
Agreed. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
But can we correctly read this? To complain that Mr. Amos has committed ethics violations relating to submitting a zoning request at all, failure to disclose the zoning connection as early as April 4th.
Okay, then let's start with the first one is there an ethics violation by filing a zoning application? As an issue?
Yes. Is there specific substantiated evidence?
Right.
To support a reasonable belief of that. Yes. I guess that would be my motion to find that there has not been.
And certainly it's undisputed that the application was filed, but not evidence of the violation and something.
Right.
I agree. He'd have no recourse anywhere else.
Next issue I had pertaining to that was the contention that Mr. Amos should have recused himself from proceedings pertaining to that zoning application. His response was that he did so.
Right, I thought there wasn't a fact issue left about whether or not he disclosed it and then said. I thought the issue that Mr. Rorke was trying to raise was that it was too late in the game. He did it on May 1st, he should have done it at least as early as April 4th.
But were there any, let me phrase it this way, I saw nothing in either party's submissions that indicated that there was any action brought before or taken by the board on that application between April the 4th and May the 1st.
Right.
I didn't see.
I agree.
That's what I understand from the facts.
So do we have a motion then on that one?
Motion is to find that there is no specific substantiated evidence from a credible source to support a reasonable belief that there's been an ethics violation arising from the timing of Mr. Amos's disclosure of a conflict related to his own.
Second.
All in favor?
All in favor.
In favor. In favor. Any other issues that we need to address?
The public statement before the media. Have we addressed that one?
No, we have not. Although, well, we have not. It appeared to be undisputed as a factual matter that it was not a statement by Mr. Amos. It was made by his wife.
Well, neither was the transaction in his name. So I think we go beyond Mr. Amos, but I don't think a statement to the press in this situation, or the media, I should say, of a significant transaction that could theoretically help the county and citizens of the county is an inappropriate action, even given his position.
Right, I agree with that. And I'll just say, for what it's worth, I did not even understand Mr. Rorke to be saying that the announcement by itself was some sort of ethical violation, rather than it was just a culmination of events that he concluded was morally wrong.
Should we, in litigation terms, construe it broadly and as a potential issue?
Having said that, I agree that you could read that as another statement by Mr. Rorke of there being an ethical violation, so I think we should.
Is there a motion?
Yes. The motion would be that we find that there is not specific substantiated evidence from a credible source to support a reasonable belief that there's been a violation of the ethics rules relating to the announcement by family members about the development. That was mentioned by Mr. Ward in the next to last paragraph of the second.
I would second, I agree.
I agree as well. Is that it? Anything else that we need to say?
Well, we did have some discussion about whether we should, well, the question was as to recusal from business with Lamar. The question there was, the problem there was prospective versus.
Right, and we did that on
this. We did deal with that. And I guess there one main issue might be whether or not it's a proper use. It's important we have some discussion about that. See, we can't, we were already on the same page about that. Maybe we should address it formally.
Well, for one thing, a conflict with using similar attorneys is a the complainant normally is one of the clients, right, as there being a conflict of interest. The law firm doesn't represent the county. They might represent.
Yeah, I think we can
Mr. Amos, but
we can take judicial notice from the various filings that the county has an attorney who's not a member of this firm. So that could have been.
Yes,
you're right. The firm doesn't represent the county.
He personally has hired this attorney that comes before the
the board, I'm trying to analogize it to a litigation matter. You're a judge, you privately hire a lawyer to help with something, but that lawyer comes before you.
Then you recuse yourself. But in little towns, they don't. What was it, Lincoln who said, a town better have two attorneys, otherwise the one remaining will starve? Something to that effect.
So is that the situation we have here?
Well, and looking back at the initial complaint, what I'm struggling with is what is this issue that he doesn't think Mr. Amos can, quote unquote, it's his quotes, rule on? Are we again talking about prospective matters that may come before the board in the future, or because there's no indication that this law firm, just like the developer, had any connection with the votes taken on February the 20th.
Right. I'm looking at the complaint. Furthermore, the law firm, Lipscomb Johnson et al., is the attorney of record for Lennar, as it is for Mr. Amos. There's no way Mr. Amos can objectively rule on this issue, given the interconnection such as these. Well, this issue would be, well,
is it the zoning?
Well, the two issues that he could be referring to is the zoning and the roadblock. In the preceding paragraph, he just talks about all discussion votes and recommendations brought to the board for action or improvements. But I think in the next paragraph he's referring to, when he said this issue, he's referring to the zoning and the roadblock.
Law firms don't make decisions. They might get home cooking if they're there often enough, but they don't make decisions. And it's a specialty type law firm, I believe. At least Mr. Lipscomb is known in the area.
So if that's a go-to firm, let's just say, they know the ins and outs of how these zoning issues work, therefore they're sought after for that expertise. Mr. Amos, aware of that, it's hard, obviously, other clients, chooses to hire them. Now they come before him with something unrelated. Is he influenced to help the lawyer's client out by virtue of the fact that that's his lawyer? Is advocating that other unrelated matter to him?
Well, you know, on a malpractice insurance application every year, in recent years, the insurer asks, what is your method of determining any conflicts among potential clients? Do you have some sort of search arrangement? Who's the person in the firm who does it? Since I'm a one-person firm with a paralegal, I ultimately look at it. And they want you to develop a system. So now you have someone who goes and does this type of work, it's specialized type of work, and he's represented, or his firm has represented different people in that same area. Mm-hmm. Is it a conflict in and of itself? I think the complaint of conflict falls with the client. That's the potential of conflict. When we worry about conflicts, we worry about the client complaining. By representing another client, you're in a conflicted position as to my situation. What he's arguing is the reverse. He's basically saying it's an advantaged position, not a conflicted position. That is, the conflict produces an advantage, not a disadvantage. All of us would face the reverse of that if one were to complain about it.
And presumably, the advantage would flow to being based upon the relationship with the firm
or at least an attorney in the firm, would flow to everyone who came before the commission as a client of that firm.
Yes, I'd agree. They're out of business, aren't they?
Well,
going in front of this commission, yeah.
Yeah, if it's a conflict, and I guess that, you know, then the question becomes, to kind of get back to your original point, if it's a conflict, do they have to withdraw from representing everybody else, or does Mr. Amos have to withdraw from casting votes on any matter they bring?
Well, that's what, of course, Mr. Rorke is suggesting. You don't run into this in Metro Atlanta that often.
No.
You see this in little towns all the time.
Yeah, where there's only a handful of attorneys in town and one does the real estate work, or maybe two.
I think it's more of a potential and a suggestion of wrong that is totally unsubstantiated. It's a projection as to the future. And it should, the objection could be made on any occasion when this law firm represents a client in front of the commission. That an objection could be made then. And it was, well, we don't determine that in the future.
True.
I think it is a prospective matter, but it is a little trouble when here's Mr. Amos having confidential communication with his lawyers. Those lawyers come before him on something else, but the lawyer understands well his duty, but he's not to engage in, should engage in ex parte communication with an attorney in that situation, related to unrelated, you know, the other related clients that lawyer has. Now, is it too dangerous in the situation? Is that an appearance of impropriety?
Well, and then you get to the whole issue of at least the U.S. Supreme Court cases that talk about the issue in the context of campaign contributions to judges, you know, where one person contributed, I don't remember the number, but some astronomical percentage of a judge's total campaign contributions, they found an appearance of impropriety requiring recusal. But at the same time have repeatedly said that just because a lawyer makes a contribution is not a basis for recusal.
Right, you have to balance First Amendment.
Right.
It's a matter for legislation. It's really not a matter for us to talk about, I think. I mean, I can see the potential of harm.
Yeah.
I agree with you, but I think it's a matter for perhaps the commission to change some of the rules.
Has he identified circumstances in which that has happened?
Well,
he's the attorney of record. I don't know what record that means. I mean, I read that. I thought it was record. It must mean pending cases, but he's not identifying it. This would be a
I'm assuming, I think I saw in the response a copy of the zoning application from April the 4th.
Or to show a different law firm.
And it listed the name of the developer and the law firm and the owners of the property. So I guess in that sense, there's something in our record identifying that in fact there is that representation.
Beginning where the respondent is identifying this law firm as being his lawyer.
Yes. Well, and more than just him, but.
Well, but I was taking that to be true. So.
Yeah. I was going to say.
The issue is whether or not those same lawyers are in front of Mr. Amos on unrelated matters.
That I have no idea.
Well, let's look at it from a different angle. Under Section 15, under the disciplinary action, looking at it, the only
viable action that I look at here from my vantage point is a written warning, censure, or reprimand.
Right.
I don't think it comes to the point of a censure or reprimand, but we could put a warning.
Well, but I think that has to be read in the context, it can only be done after an evidentiary hearing, but also in the context of a violation that has occurred. I don't think warning is used in the sense of, you know,
it's
a shot across the bow. It's
right.
a punishment,
right.
not a heads up.
For a specific act.
Yeah, I think that comes back to if there's a concern that any employee or official can ask for an advisory opinion and then at that point either be told, you know, we think you should, in this case, recuse, or no, you don't have to, and then it's been addressed. I think that's where you get the prospective ruling, I guess, for lack of a better term.
Like a declaratory statement.
Right.
Judgment.
Right.
To me, this is sort of an ancillary issue. The big issue
right.
was the vote and the participation.
Yeah, where I'm hung up on now, going through this, you know, I see the potentially troubling aspects of it, but I've not seen the evidence, specific substantiated evidence of exactly this kind of situation actually arising. It says off the record, and I think I was making assumptions, but I don't know, other than this, other than Mr. Amos's particular situation, he's already saying from the zoning. I don't see the evidence of the law firm of Mr. Scott Johnson, et cetera, being the attorney of record for Lenore in matters before the board where Mr. Amos is not saying.
I agree, it's based upon what we have.
Certainly.
So on that basis, I would move to find there's no specific substantiated evidence from credible sources to support a reasonable belief that there's been a violation of the ethics ordinance related to Mr. Amos using the law firm that Mr. Rorke alleges also represents the Lenore, Georgia.
I certainly agree.
I agree as well. Any other matters that need to be addressed?
I don't think so.
Yes, ma'am.
Before y'all conclude, or the meeting's concluded, I do have forms for you to fill out in order to receive compensation.
I think there's no other business to be brought before the panel. I will entertain that motion to adjourn.
Agree.
So moved or seconded.
Motion carries. Thank you.
Nice to meet both of
you. Good pleasure to go to your office.
Can I give her another contact?
Well done.
How you doing today?
Good.
You brought the side. That piece of shit.
Any more questions?
I read this in dispersion. I read it, put it down, digested it. Read it again.
Thank you.
I did too, but I read it in the document. I got a word in the book. They should be one of the charm.
I'm sorry, I'm not. I just get each of your names so I have them spelled correctly.
The document.
I'll just give you one of my cards.
I left them back at my desk.
Thank you so much.
Okay.
One thing I learned a long time ago was that I had
something
to have. Hi, Nydia. How are you?
I'm good.
Jeff. I've never met you.
I'm Nydia.
Hey, yeah. Very nice to meet you. I've heard about you. I've seen you on TV before, but I haven't met you. And I follow you on Twitter, actually. So.
Oh, great. Thank you. Very
nice
much.
To meet you.
I appreciate that.
Absolutely.
Do you have a card?
I do.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Thanks very much.
Hey, how are you?
Good. Jeff Lee Cohn.
Hey, very nice to meet you.
Glad to meet you.
Can you get a new story of any kind out of this?
Yeah, you know. So it's just a follow-up to what we had done before. So.
What you've done before.
Yeah,
well,
so
I'm glad to see you.
Everyone, you know, we like to try to put, I shouldn't say closure, but we like to try to follow things when we can. So.
Well, there'll be things coming up from time to time.
That's what I know. I knew that about
myself. I'm glad to see you. You have some attention here. I'm really pleased.
Yeah, absolutely.
I know several homeowners in the area have written to you, sent you emails. We're pleased that you've responded on it, really.
Yeah, they've gotten some good emails from folks, so I appreciate that.
Hopefully I'll get some news stories out of it.
Yeah, we are.
It keeps me as a subscriber to the AJC. Have you ever driven down Castleberry Road?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. We were so there a few months ago.
You know why the homeowners questioned why it should be five lanes.
Yeah. You got a second?
Yeah.
Do you do it right here, or where would you like to do it?
Well, we have you want to do it, Jeff. This
is
fine. In there. There's that flag.
Am I doing it?
No,
I'm a flag.
And everything. Very specific. Like you were saying, what was the,
I think the second
what was the source of the 15,000? Remember 15,000 cars per day?
Not the go hunting. Go hunting. You know?
Oh, no, she's fine. Right? Excuse me, I've been working today, guys. Yeah. Got wet in my pants.
Yeah, somebody must have been doing some outdoors activities.
Yeah, we have a plumbing business. I have to actually work sometimes. And you just moved, or are you going
to? No, I'm just going to put him.
Oh. He needs to be underneath this cap.
I started to say you're.
All right, so are you good?
Yeah.
What's your reaction to the board's decision today?
I think this ethics board did a good job. They took all facts into consideration, and I'm pleased with their findings, what went on to the complainant's findings.
Based on the complaints that you have heard, will you do anything differently going forward?
Well, I have everything going forward. I will ask our attorney. I've asked him again, should I vote on this or that? And most of his decision, if I have no financial interest in it, there's no problem, no reason I shouldn't vote on it. And that's one of the biggest things. If you have any financial that benefits you in any way in financial future development or anything. So I would exercise my duty as county commissioner.
Why didn't you recuse yourself on that February 20th vote about the widening of Castleberry?
I saw no reason to. There was no conflict of any interest for me anywhere. And something, I don't want to say they missed it, but they said there was no money spent on Castleberry Road, but there was already $10 million spent in 2000. As you well know before in the last interview, $10 million was spent on right-of-way that we hadn't approved. It came from the previous Board of Commissioners, who had the foresight to go ahead and plan and start spending money on Castleberry Road.
When did you start talking to Lennar about the sale of your property?
Well, my family, as the paper says, my wife's family has owned that property more than 60 years. It's been for sale for quite a few years. Their mother is almost approaching 100 years old. And so it's been for sale for a while, so they've been talking to quite a few builders. Now, I do not know exact dates. We've talked to Lennar, but it's been for sale for 4 or 5 years now.
Were you talking to Lennar before that February 20th vote?
I cannot say positively where we were or not. We were talking to quite a few developers, and they were all looking at what plans they could do. So I wouldn't say we wasn't, but I'm not clear when we started talking to Lennar.
And do you or your family stand to financially gain from the widening of Castleberry?
No, sir, I do not think so at all. Most people come out to Castleberry Road would turn left. Why would you drive 3 miles back towards 20 when you could come out 20 anyway? Bethview Road's going to be widened. It's been widened since, 2000. It's a state project with our county. And it's being widened, so we felt it was a good time to sell. We didn't want to overburden the roads. I think we'll flow on Bethview Road and not Castleberry Road. I don't see any reason. Castleberry Road, we own no property there. Like I said, my son lives in a subdivision off Castleberry, but I don't see any way that could benefit us, my family, in any way at all.
Yeah. And so you don't see that as a bypass to another road for potential residents that could have increased the sale price of the property that you're selling?
actually not. I don't see why anybody would go Casper Road to get over to Shamley Gap Road when Shamley Gap comes off Kelly Mill.
You've stepped into ethics issues in the past. Are, going forward, are you going to do anything differently just to make sure that you don't get wrapped up in yet another ethics investigation, another ethics complaint?
I will do what I feel is right for the county and the county I love and take care of. I will do what I feel is right for it.
How many ethics complaints have been filed against you?
I don't keep track of them. Most of them have been cleared. You may ask Nydia, she may know. she loves to broadcast them on her network, so you can ask her.
But so are you going to do anything differently moving forward?
I'm going to take care of my county. And if I feel it's not ethical, I will ask the question. I went before the board to ask a question about water, and they told me I should not vote on it, so I didn't. So I will do what I feel is best for the county.
And so going forward, will you vote on issues related to Lennar?
I will ask the question and see if it's ethical to do it. If it's not, if I have no financial interest in it, if it doesn't benefit me, there's no reason I shouldn't be able to vote on it. But I may seek legal advice.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jeff.
I appreciate it.
Okay,
thanks,
man.
Thanks for seeing
you. See you, Nydia.
Goodbye.
See you, man.
Thanks.
Appreciate it.
Appreciate it.
Uh-huh. Nice seeing you again. Nydia, do you have a second?
Yes, I filed a complaint against candidate Amos.
Oh yeah, I know.
when he was running for office, and he had several several properties that he did not disclose.
Yes, I saw that story. I just watched it within the past month or so.
Okay.
That was when? What year was that?
4 years ago.
Yeah, I think that was right around the time that I was just coming here. So I came from Pennsylvania, so I wasn't familiar with everything. But yeah, do you have a second just to talk with us? Do you
sure.
mind?
Sure, and I want to
record it as well.
Do it.
Sure.
If you don't mind, line my
would you mind?
Camera up.
Oh yeah.
Once you get us situated.
Let's see.
How are you, sir?
Good. How are you doing?
Very well, thank you. Lights off. You good? So it's Nydia. Spell your first and last name for me.
Nydia Tisdale, Nydia Tisdale.
What did you make of the allegations against Commissioner Amos here that he perhaps stands to benefit from widening Castleberry?
I think there is a possibility. I haven't researched it myself personally, but it seemed like the allegations did have some merit.
Is this something, do you think a commissioner who stands to earn some $20 to $30 million off a sale of a property should recuse himself if, in fact, that there is some sort of infrastructure decision being made that could affect that area?
Yes, I do indeed. I think that the property value does stand a chance of increasing because of the road widening, and I think out of an abundance of caution and prudence, the commissioner in question should have recused himself from that vote.
You know, Commissioner Amos has been, I think I said earlier, he's been in several ethics issues and investigations complaints. You filed one. Is this par for the course for this commissioner, or what is your thoughts on this type of?
4 years ago, I filed an ethics complaint against then candidate Ralph Amos, and he goes by the nickname of Pete Amos, and his wife and he owned together over 80 properties in Forsyth County and elsewhere, and they disclosed about half a dozen properties, and so they filed an amended disclosure statement and listed the initial properties that they had omitted from his financial disclosure statement as a candidate. And one of those properties, coincidentally, was where the jail and courthouse is now being constructed. So that was one property I had overlooked in disclosing initially until my complaint was filed 4 years ago. And to my knowledge, it has yet to be adjudicated by the State Ethics Commission.
Oh, they're still looking into it.
I think it's not been ruled upon, correct?
And so he sold, after he became the commissioner, he sold the property to the county for the jail and the courthouse?
Yes, correct.
So he profited in some way from that?
Well, it was his wife's family's property. It was in a trust, and there may be half a dozen different family members who all received proceeds from the sale of that property.
The property that they didn't disclose, the properties they didn't disclose, does that happen to be the property that we're talking about now over on Chambly Gap Road?
Do you remember if that was disclosed? Actually, no, I think that one was on the initial disclosure. To the best of my recollection, I think that was one of the few that they did disclose.
Does this commissioner have trouble staying on the straight and narrow?
That's a good question, and because he's so connected with so many different entities, I think there probably are other items that he should recuse and perhaps hasn't. Again, I haven't researched all of that. I do know that there were close to 80 properties and the majority of them were not disclosed. So that begs the question, and it also invites more scrutiny,
should the public trust what's happening in the commissioner's office?
Well, I think the public is wise to pay attention and to attend meetings and to question votes and question transactions, absolutely, yes. And that's why I attend meetings with my camera, so that others can watch meetings that they're unable to attend. And my filming is a little bit different from the county's filming in that I will capture the reactions of the listeners and not just film the speakers.
Good job. Thank you, Nydia.
Thank you very
pleasure.
Much, Jeff.
Good
I
meeting
appreciate
you
it. And I hope there was something in that
yeah,
you could choose.
Absolutely. I like what you said towards the end.